This is our first PowerPoint at looking at the 1920s, this great decade in American history where we see so much change. However, there was, and interestingly enough, a part of America, an aspect when we think of those things that we have to write our summary paragraph at the end of each notes about, when we think of social changes, when we think of economic changes, when we think of political changes. The political changes that actually occurred during the 1920s was actually a move back away from the progressive, very activist presidents that had been around ever since the turn of the century, beginning with Theodore Roosevelt. And so what we see here in the 1920s is a more conservative move, a move back to when presidents didn't involve themselves so much in the economy.
Republicans seized on the people's apathy, thrusting conservative Ohio Senator Warren Harding into the spotlight.
During one of his campaign speeches, Warren Harding said, "It's time for normalcy." And this idea of return to normalcy really resonated in American politics.
Harding's promise to return the nation to normalcy was really a rejection of progressivism. The belief that the nation should not be governed from 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. In many ways, it's a return to the 19th century model of the presidency, the idea that the Congress will pass laws, that business will make money, and the president will just mind his own business.
Harding wins an amazing victory, and what will he then do with his mandate? He wants to restore party rule, which meant that the Congress and the House and the Senate and the White House would work together and build a consensus.
As the 29th president, Harding was happy to take a step back and let Republicans who dominated Congress by a 3-to-1 margin initiate policy. His administration pushed for a more streamlined government, cutting taxes, clamping down on unions, and having the Federal Reserve raise interest rates. And where men like Roosevelt and Wilson had dictated to their cabinet, Harding let his have free rein.
The biggest scandal of the Harding administration was a Teapot Dome scandal. And this involved the Department of Interior.
The Secretary of the Interior, Albert Fall, was one of Harding's Ohio gang cronies, going back to the president's days as a senator.
What he had done was sell out oil, Navy oil reserves, to a couple of big oil men. He was the first cabinet member to ever go to jail.
Harding tried to deflect attention from the scandals by going on a very public, months-long tour of the western states, including the first presidential trip to Alaska. His efforts came to an abrupt end in San Francisco.
He gets up there and it's like, oh, I don't feel good. They think he's gotten some bad crab, okay, some bad seafood. And what he's had is a heart attack.
Harding died on August 2nd, 1923, at age 57. His sudden death prevented any chance at repairing his image, that of a weak executive who did little to enhance the office of the president. At 2:30 in the morning, 51-year-old Vice President Calvin Coolidge was awakened at his family's Vermont home with the news of Harding's death.
So the Democrats have a large problem, and that is the split in their party that's becoming evident in 1924. You have William Gibbs McAdoo, who is kind of a William Jennings Bryan Democrat. He was actually in Woodrow Wilson's cabinet as Secretary of Treasury. He's also related to Woodrow Wilson. He's his son-in-law. And he is someone who's a little bit close to the Klan. He's more of like a Southern kind of Democrat. And he believes in some things like labor unions and farm subsidies and regulation of industry and things like that. But culturally and socially, this is a guy who is much closer to that Southern Democratic vibe than an urban Democratic vibe. And that urban Democratic vibe is growing. And that is Al Smith, who's a Catholic from New York City, who represents more of that urban, ethnic, anti-Klan strain of the Democratic Party that is growing and now bumping up against this more rural conservative Democratic strain. So after 103 ballots, I said it, 103 ballots, which is crazy, they finally both had to withdraw their names and they end up with John Davis, the compromise candidate, who represents a little bit of both. He is an urbanite. He's a Wall Street lawyer with a lot of connections to big business, like the Rockefeller Foundation, the Council on Foreign Affairs, the Carnegie Institute. This is a guy that's very well connected, but he's also a former senator from West Virginia. So the Democrats are thinking that they can solidify their southern base and still appeal to some more urbanites with this character, John Davis. And John Davis is kind of a weird guy. Even though sometimes he's going to come out and condemn the KKK, he's also going to fight against some big reforms like child labor laws at the national level or anti-lynching laws at the national level. And later on in life, he's actually going to defend segregation in one of the Brown versus Board cases, arguing in front of the Supreme Court for separate is equal. So this John Davis character is a compromise character that really isn't going to appeal to that many Democrats outside of the Deep South. But here's the larger problem, that there is another party in town. So Robert La Follette, the fighting Wisconsin governor, fighting Bob, he doesn't want to be a Republican anymore. The Teddy Roosevelt progressive Republican streak that we talked about before with Hiram Johnson in California, who was still fighting for the nomination, would lose it in the Republican Party. The progressives want to bolt, and they're going to do it in 1916 with the Progressive Party. But they're not so much going to split up the Republican Party at this point, which is solidifying around a conservative base. They're going to split up the Democratic Party, and really the populists and the urban northern ethnic Democrats that are going to go for La Follette instead of the more conservative John Davis. So let's take a look at the election, we'll take a look at some of the big issues, and then we'll say goodbye. So it would appear that Calvin Coolidge sounds almost a little bit like a progressive. He's trying to hold on to some of the progressive roots of the Republican Party. I mean, he's talking about the 8-hour workday. He's talking about federal legislation to go after child labor. He's talking about anti-lynching laws in terms of, you know, having some equality and talking about racial relations a little bit, although he would never condemn the KKK. But the Republicans are running a campaign on, you know, stay cool with Coolidge. Let's stay with the tide. Let's keep the peace. Silent Cal is the way to go. If you enjoy your life now, why would you change it? Coolidge is also, at least superficially, looking like he's dealing with some of the corruption problems that occurred under Harding. You have the Teapot Dome scandal. And even though Coolidge isn't throwing these guys out and arresting them and cleaning up Washington, it has the appearance that he's being methodical, he's being pragmatic, he's dealing with the situation. And Cal was really good at that. That looked like he was in charge, that he's a quiet guy, but he knows what he's doing, that we can trust Cal. And of course, the Davis campaign is running a much more conservative campaign. They did have Charles Bryan as the vice president, who was the brother of William Jennings Bryan, to try to appeal to that populist segment. But for the most part, they're a pretty conservative campaign. They talked a little bit about farm subsidies, some limited public work programs, but times are good. Their unemployment's pretty low. In fact, most of their platform sounds a little bit kind of conservative and anti-progressive. They're talking about, fighting against anti-lynching laws. They're talking about fighting against child labor laws. They're talking about, you know, not supporting the 8-hour workday because they believe it's a states' rights issue. So you have Calvin Coolidge, who believes in limited government. You have Davis, who believes in states' rights, which is a limited government. And you have the progressives, which are fighting for the old progressive things like regulation of the railroads and the ownership of public utilities like water. They're talking about huge farm subsidies and price controls to help farmers out where there's an overproduction problem. So what La Follette is doing is he's trying to create this coalition of kind of farm labor and labor unions in cities and the former Debs socialist under this umbrella of kind of pragmatic progressism in the spirit of Teddy Roosevelt. But because he's a third party, he's just not going to have enough steam. But at the end of the day, that electoral map right there shows you that this is a conservative electorate. You only have the very deep South, the former Confederate states that are voting for Davis. You have Wisconsin, who goes progressive, and La Follette did pretty good in those northern western states. But it's not enough to really make a huge impact. If anything, it's breaking up the populist and the Democratic vote that Charles Bryan was supposed to bring in for the Democrats. So the Democrats are going to get decimated.
Coolidge became president just as the economy was showing signs of recovery from the post-World War Depression, and he believed he knew how to keep it growing.
Wilson had very high taxes in World War I. Harding started to bring them down. Then Coolidge came along and said, that's not enough. It must be much lower.
Coolidge, like Harding before him, signed sharp tax reductions into law. The top income tax rate during World War I had been 77%. Under Coolidge, it reached a low of 25%. What followed was a spending binge the likes of which the country had never seen. Under President Calvin Coolidge, the optimism of the Roaring Twenties had swept the nation. Coolidge had declared, "The business of America is business."
It was called the Coolidge Prosperity, and a lot of people gave him credit for that.
Reagan was a teenager when Calvin Coolidge was president, and greatly admired him. When Reagan went to the White House, he put up a picture of Calvin Coolidge.
After finishing out the last year of Harding's term and riding a wave of good feeling and popularity, Coolidge easily won re-election. He was inaugurated on a cool day in early March 1925. Thousands had gathered in the Capitol to watch, but for the first time, millions of others were listening.
Calvin Coolidge is the first president that more than a few Americans had actually heard. This has a tremendous impact on the country and his popularity.
And in some ways, because he was naturally introverted, he found public speaking, which he could prepare for, as a way to get his ideas across very effectively.
On behalf of his own people, and as President of the United States.
Before the radio, how did you give a speech before the mic? You bellowed, and Coolidge was not a bellower. And there was this great sudden surprise, which is the radio was coming in, and the voice that was poor for the lecture hall was ideal for radio.
Coolidge was also resolute in his fiscal conservatism. When prices for farm commodities began slipping, Congress passed a bill to use government funds to keep farmers afloat. Coolidge vetoed it. Though thousands of small farmers went under, his veto underscored that even a conservative president still had the opportunity to brandish the power of the office.
The presidency is supposed to be about policy, but of course it's really about temperament, isn't it? It's about who you are and how you react under pressure. Coolidge reacted by stopping, halting, preventing. Coolidge was the great refrainer.
Leading candidates were Herbert Hoover, the Secretary of Commerce, Frank Orrin Lowden, the former governor of Illinois, and Senate Majority Leader Charles Curtis, who was from my home state of Kansas. Not impressed by these choices, many Republicans tried to draft Coolidge, but Coolidge turned it down. Hoover ended up getting the nomination, with Charles Curtis as his running mate. The Democratic Party nominated Al Smith, the governor of New York, who was running for president a third time. Smith was the first Roman Catholic to be a major party's candidate for president. The Democrats nominated Joseph Taylor Robinson, a U.S. senator from Arkansas, as his running mate. Robinson and Smith seemed like the odd couple, but actually complemented each other well. No third parties really stood out during this election at all, and so we had another classic two-way battle. Hoover had the momentum due to the fact that things were going pretty darn well overall in the country. In fact, at Hoover's nomination acceptance speech, he said, quote,
"We in America today are nearer to the final triumph over poverty than ever before in the history of this land. We shall soon, with the help of God, be in sight of the day when poverty will be banished from this land."
Unquote. Little did Hoover know that soon those words would come back to bite him in the butt. However, things were looking pretty good now for him, especially since Al Smith's religion became a major issue during the campaign. Many Protestants feared that Smith would take orders from the Pope if he led the country. In addition to anti-Catholicism, Smith's opposition to prohibition and his association with the corruption of Tammany Hall likely would cost him votes. And here are the results. Herbert Hoover easily won, becoming the 31st president in American history. In the Electoral College, he dominated so much it was a bit embarrassing for the Democrats. Hoover received 444 electoral votes and even won states like North Carolina and Virginia, which hadn't voted Republican since 1872. Al Smith received just 87 electoral votes. Hoover also dominated with the popular vote, getting 58.2% to Smith's 40.8%. It was safe to say the Republicans were on a roll, as this was their third consecutive presidential landslide victory. Charles Curtis became the 31st vice president in American history. Fun fact and spoiler alert, this was the last presidential election in American history won by Republicans without either Richard Nixon or a member of the Bush family running for them. Pretty crazy, eh? I'll see you for the next election, buddy.
The torch of conservative leadership was passed to Herbert Hoover, Coolidge and Harding's well-respected Secretary of Commerce. On the morning of March 4, 1929, Herbert Hoover was inaugurated as a storm moved over the nation's capital, soaking the crowd of thousands that had gathered to watch the 31st President of the United States take the oath of office. The gloomy weather would turn out to be a harbinger of things to come.
Everybody expected great things from Herbert Hoover. His basic mantra was rugged individualism.
Here's a guy orphaned at a young age. He'll become a mining engineer. By the time he's in his mid-30s, he's wealthy. He's a multimillionaire.
We've had presidents who were politicians, of course. We've had presidents who were lawyers. We've had presidents who were generals. But Herbert Hoover is the one conspicuous illustration of a businessman president.
But Hoover, raised as a Quaker, found his real calling in public service and politics.
He was called the great humanitarian because of his enormous feats of organization at the end of World War I in preventing famine in Europe and the Soviet Union.
When he ran for the presidency, he promised a chicken in every pot and a car in every garage. He sort of assumed that he would oversee the beginning of perpetual prosperity.
America's unprecedented economic boom had fueled an explosive uptick in the nation's stock market. Between 1920 and 1929, an increasing number of wealthy and upper middle class people put their money in the stock market. As a result, stock values on average rose as much as 400%.
If he had been elected in 1920, Herbert Hoover would have been a great president, perhaps on the order of a Theodore Roosevelt. But it was his misfortune to be the right man at the wrong time.
On October 24th, 1929, just 7 months into Hoover's term, the market crashed. It kicked off a week of frenzied trading as investors ran for the exits, and the market lost 23% of its value.
There's a general consensus that speculation, growing disparities of wealth, and a lack of regulation, all policies pursued by Republican presidents in the 1920s, contributed to both the crash and the Depression.
Nobody knew that we were entering the Great Depression. His first idea was, do nothing. He talked about it like it was a hurricane, like it was something that swept through. It will cleanse the economy.
To kind of return back to the idea of disarmament at the end of World War I, we have the passage of what was called the Kellogg-Briand Pact. The Kellogg-Briand Pact was a treaty that was signed between the United States and several other European countries. Now, what's interesting here to note is that, as we saw at the end of World War I, the United States was not part of the League of Nations. And therefore, as you saw in the previous slide when it talked about disarmament and kind of shrinking the size of people's militaries and their individual ships, these were all efforts made by the United States outside of the League of Nations. And as a result, several of them were not the result of the United States being part of them, mind you, but the fact that trying to outlaw war simply was just a ridiculous concept, especially after what people had seen as the result of, you know, lesser armed countries during the Great War. And here we are just a few years later trying to propose the outlawing of war. And that's exactly, in fact, what the Kellogg-Briand Pact suggested. It literally said that World War I should have been and should be the war to end all wars. And it basically said that war was now illegal. It stated that war was no longer a legal means of countries trying to settle their differences. And we think about that and we look at that and go, this is a ridiculous idea. The idea that you could somehow outlaw war is absolutely ridiculous. There was nothing in the pact to try and allow countries to try and enforce this. There was no way to back this up. How do you, in fact, enforce a law that says war is illegal without willing to risk war in order to stop war? It's kind of like a dog chasing its tail. It's, you know, how do you stop aggression without willing to be aggressive in stopping the aggressors? And that unfortunately was the downfall of the Kellogg-Briand Pact. But again, you know, you have these public officials from various countries shaking their hands and signing this very piece of paper that probably looked very nice behind glass and hung in a very nice office. During Coolidge's presidency, one of the big achievements that was made during his brief 4 years as president was that he and Charles Dawes had made what was called the Dawes Plan. Now, if you guys remember, at the end of the First World War, Germany was saddled with an enormous amount of debt they had to pay. That money would then be paid to primarily the French and the British as war reparations. The French and the British, in turn, also had debts and owed the United States quite a bit of money. However, because Germany very early on could not make payments on its World War I reparations, France and Great Britain also were finding it very hard to pay back the United States. And so Charles Dawes came up with an interesting idea. This was the vice president at the time under Calvin Coolidge. Basically, this involved loaning very large amounts of money to Germany in order to allow them to make their payments from war reparations. That money simply would be recycled once it was paid to France and Great Britain. France and Great Britain would then send it back to the United States, and everybody seemed to be happy. The problem, though, was when the stock market went bust at the end of the 1920s, the very beginning of the Depression, the first thing that American investors did was they stopped sending money over to Germany, which caused Germany, and then by chain reaction, France and Great Britain, to fall into a bigger hole, and was one of the reasons why Germany, in particular, suffered probably the worst during the Great Depression, even more than what we'll see happen in the United States and other countries in Europe. And of course, it was due to that Great Depression, especially in Germany, that gave rise to all kinds of extreme organizations offering very extreme solutions to the problem. One of the groups offering those extreme solutions, of course, was the Nazi Party and its very vocal leader, Adolf Hitler.